Hello, this is Mike Wilmot with Microsoft. I am a technical specialist with Microsoft covering database and business intelligence. I want to cover today some geospatial reporting with Microsoft reporting services that I've put together. I've also put David Golub on here. He's a platform architect with Microsoft, and he has actually done a ton of work on this topic. If you go to his YouTube site here, that's the 10-Minute College site, then you will find a lot of his great work here. And he's actually been kind enough to share with me the collateral he had to create that site. So thanks, Dave, for that. And my goal is to actually replicate the work that he's done and kind of solve the same problem and publish this to Channel 9. So if I click on his site here, you'll find that he's got lots of great work, and specifically on the 311 problem of the San Francisco data that we're going to look at today. He's done a lot of work on that. There's part one, part two, and part three of this work. And so he was kind enough to lend me all his assets and virtual machines, and I was able to piece it together. But he did an amazing amount of work ahead of time. So I'd really recommend you check out this site on YouTube. There's a lot of great content here. So the problem that we want to solve today is this 311 incident management problem for San Francisco. We want to do that by looking at the capabilities of the Microsoft Geospatial platform and figure out a strategy to solve the business problem that we're looking at. And again, this is a replica of Dave's work, and so let's go ahead and get started. And you can reach out to either of us for if you have questions. The problem that we're trying to solve is that the city manager of San Francisco wants a reporting system that can track city services incidents. These are 311 incidents. They're not 411 in the sense they're not emergency, but they are important to be solved. She wants to find all the 311 incidents within a 200-meter buffer of a given road segment, and that would include adjacent streets. An example of that would be, what are all the 311 incidents and their age around the road segment one of Geary Boulevard? And then, so just to remind you, 311 incidents are things like repairs needed, graffiti, cleanup that needs to be done, abandoned vehicles, eyesores, things like that in the city that need cleaned up. So the city is presentable and is attractive to folks that visit it. The things or the abilities that are built into Microsoft Geospatial are a great database engine to store the data, the lat long geospatial information, key performance indicators, metrics, things like that. You want on top of that a reporting layer with a designer like reporting services that's got data management abilities that you're able to create data sets and data sources with parameters. You also want to have a mapping layer like a Bing Maps that you can plot mapping data on a visual surface. You also want to have spatial data types like geography and geometry. And those would have methods that you can do things like create a point from a well-known text field. You can also do things like spatial temporal methods. That's what the ST means. So you can show it as text. You can get buffers around certain points, and you can find intersections. So this first one here, you're getting the geometric point from a well-known text. This one, you're converting that back to a text method, well-known text, and then this is getting a buffer and intersection around a given point. If you look at a well-known text, what that is, it's kind of a standard in the geospatial community. And it's how do you represent things like points and line strings and polygons. In the case that we're looking at today, we're going to be really focused on line strings and polygons here. These line strings will represent streets, and the polygons can represent buffers around those streets. And we'll look at that. But this isn't just a Microsoft SQL Server notion. It crosses multiple platforms. It even gets into multi-part geospatial items. Now, if you look at some of these methods from SQL Server, this one right here is a static method, and static methods are different than instance methods in the sense that they don't necessarily need an object type to be associated with them, like a database column. So in this case, what we're doing is we're declaring a geography type. We take a well-known text format here, a longitude first and then a latitude, and then we select that result answer. And what you get this giant binary string here that represents this well-known text. So a lot of times you'll be given data in a longitude, latitude format, but what you really want to do is get it into this well-known text, which is kind of the lingua franca that allows you to communicate from column to column in with these geospatial methods. Now, there's another method here as text. So if we want to go from this really long binary string we just created from a text point, our well-known text, we can go back into the longitude and latitude, and everything's back to where it started. You also might want to call a buffer or intersection method. This is really going to be key to solving the problem that we have, where we have incident points provided to us by the city, and then we've also got road line strings provided to us by a national shapefile database. And what we'll be doing is we'll be finding the intersection between this road line string. We'll create a 200 meter buffer around that line string and find out all the intersection points that intersect the a buffer around the incident point. So create a buffer around the road, that buffer intersects the incident point, and voila, we end up with kind of the data set that intersects the customer data, which is the report data, and then the national database of line strings that that is represented by the shapefile. So to go back to the problem, just to restate it, the city manager wants a reporting system that can track 311 incidents, and she wants to be able to find all those incidents within a 200 meter buffer of a road segment. The challenge with this is that it may not just be Geary Boulevard. It may be, if you take a 200 meter buffer on Geary Boulevard, that will definitely include side streets and alleyways and things like that that aren't necessarily on Geary Boulevard. So you would be really hard pressed to be able to solve this if you were just given lat long. And even if you had the shape file from the national database, as well as the incident points and lat longs, the national database is has geometric types, and lat long is not geometric by nature. So you'd have to try to figure out a way to use lat long and really sophisticated T-SQL that ultimately you would end up creating a geospatial data type anyway to figure out how to generate buffers and do intersections. So ultimately that's why this data type has been created, to support geography and geometry data types. Now, because it's not really possible to solve this type of a problem, at least in a straightforward, simple manner with traditional data types, what we want to do is kind of solve this problem in a stepwise way, where we get their lat long incident data, and now we have to convert that to a geography type by calling this spatial temporal method point from text. So we're going to generate this geographic data type. Then with the shapefile, we'll have these polylines that are sourced from this website here. These polylines are from this National Transportation Database, and I'll just scroll down here. You've got a bunch of items here, polylines, polygons. If you click on the one that's the National Highway Planning Network, this 49 megabyte one, what you can do is take the shapefile and convert it into a SQL Server database. There's also other methods that we had mentioned, this like point from text, this as text, this buffer method, and this intersect method. All these are on the TechNet website if you want to look at these further, but they kind of show what we already talked about in terms of some are static, meaning that they can be called without an object, and others are instance methods. So you'll see on the side here whether how to call these methods, the parameters they take, and examples of those. Let's come back here, and once we've got these polylines, we're going to convert those polylines to a shapefile that's a format that SQL Server can understand once you run through a third-party tool. So if you do a Bing search for a shapefile to SQL Server converter, you'll find that when you pass this SRID of 4326 into that shapefile, it'll convert it to an output that can be consumed by a SQL Server database as a table. There's also FIPS codes that are county and state codes within that data. We'll look at those in a little bit. The FIPS codes just allow you to slice and dice the National Transportation Database data and extract the relevant county and state that we're looking at. In our case, it's San Francisco that we care about, and we look in the state of California. And then lastly, what we want to do is Bing Maps allows us to leverage SSRS, geospatial types, and parameters in conjunction with geospatial methods like the buffer and intersect methods on the road segments and incident points to determine which street have the 301 incidents in their age. So this is really the last step is the most important, where we're combining Bing Maps, reporting services, these geospatial methods, and these road segments that we've got from the national database. So really it's a combining of the customer data as well as this national road database to kind of produce the results that we're looking for. The tools at our disposal include things like geospatial intelligence. What you see here is a SQL Server query that calls this ST point from text method, where we're creating a well-known text format with a longitude and latitude. And by calling this point from text, it's generating these spatial results that you can see that all these incident points were data points that were formed by SQL Server to show all the incidents that happened in San Francisco. And again, we have this library of instance and static methods that we can call to find out all sorts of interesting things about our data to produce the information that we want. We also have these spatially aware reporting tools that allow us to do the Bing Maps, to draw polygons around incident points, and to show us things like status of age of the incidents. And you can also do things like page to the data. You can print it. You can download it to PDFs. You can subscribe to the data through your reporting services, all that kind of stuff. So lots of power on these tools. And again, you do want to leverage these shapefiles from the National Transportation Atlas database. Once you download these, run through a third-party tool, then it forces that data to reside in SQL Server if that's what you want. And then you've got a large database of data that you can leverage and run against. So the goal here is to really combine both of these data sets. Over here, we've got all the incident points from the customer that we've converted to this common language by calling this ST point from text method on the well-known text format. And with this SRID of, again, 4326. Now, on the left side here, what we've got is this National Roadway database that, if you see all these different polylines that we've drawn, these represent all the roadways, the major roadways in San Francisco, like Geary Boulevard or Van Ness Boulevard. And so what we're doing is, by drawing a buffer around these and then correlating that to these data points of the same, roughly the same area, we're going to be able to do an intersection of the buffer around these line strings around all the road database that we have, this, you know, massive kind of Uber database of all the roads, and then this report over here that has all the incident points from the customer. So the incident points intersect somewhere inside these buffers here, and then we're given the result set that's going to allow us to do kind of visualization on top of these maps. If you want to look for further information, you can go through here and look at the polyline database from this RITA database that we talked, this national database. You can also call these spatial temporal methods that we've got on your SQL Server data to convert back and forth between kind of the well-known text format and the binary format. And like we said, if you have an ESRI shapefile, then you can convert that to a SQL Server format easily through some of these free converter tools. That wraps up the kind of slideware portion that that I mentioned. I also do want to go back as a reference to Dave Golub's 10-minute college, that probably should check this out first and foremost and run through those three videos to get a sense of how he solved this problem and the nuances therein. So hopefully this helps you get a sense of the initial problem that we're going to solve. And what we're going to do now is we're going to dive into the actual practicum of this part of the lab and of this presentation and get a sense of how to solve this practically. So we'll transition over now. So now I've converted over to the database view of things. I've got this San Francisco database that Dave had in his virtual machine. And within that, we've got this National Highway Planning Network table. We've got our initial data from the customer, the staging table. And then we've got a report table that we generated from the stage table. So we'll just look through a little bit of the data on the stage table. If we run this, we'll see that there's lots of incident points. It talks about kind of the 311 incidents, the nature of the request, the location, the district, all those types of things. At the end of this data set, you'll see a lat and a latitude and longitude. This is a helpful first step, but it doesn't really give us the geospatial data type that we need to call these geospatial methods on it. So what we'll do is we're going to run this insert statement that basically takes the key fields from the customer staging table, and it selects star from that, as well as it creates this geography type from this well-known text method and the well-known text format here. When this is run, which it already has been, so I won't run that now, what you get is you get all the same data in the stage table, but then you get this really crazy looking binary string on the right here that represents the longitude and the latitude, but it's in this binary format. So you can kind of switch between the well-known text format, which is a combination of the longitude and latitude, and then the incident point is this kind of, again, lingua franca, that it's a way of communicating between multiple systems and multiple tables that allows those tables to do all the sophisticated math between geographic types. That was that represents the report table and the stage table. If you go to the National Highway Planning Network data, this is where Dave was able to look at these FIPS codes. And actually, before I go into this second table that we're going to leverage, I do want to show you that there are spatial, anytime that you run a spatial query with spatial data, you're going to have all sorts of data points that come out of that table that represent spatial results. And so it's almost impossible to see here, but you have this little dot here, and this little dot represents lots and lots of different data points from the customer data. So what we'd want to do, if we were kind of interested in what we were seeing in this data, is we'd want to be able to enlarge this data and get a sense of what we were seeing here. So I'll kind of center this data point here. It looks like almost a little gnat on the screen. As we make this bigger and bigger, what we're going to see is that we'll have all these customer data points, and this represents a very large section of California and perhaps beyond. And if you're familiar with San Francisco, you'll start to see it kind of starts to manifest here with all these different data points. So this is a great first step in terms of being able to visualize that, yes, in fact, we do have a spatial result, and that spatial result is because of this incident point, this geospatial data type. Now, if we look at all of our roadways now, we have this National Highway Planning Network. If I execute this, this also is going to have a geospatial component to it. And that's what this road line string is. Anytime that you have this geospatial component, you're going to have a spatial result that's going to execute on that. You can see all these different roadways. And so what I've done here is I've selected the geospatial results, but there's so many here that it can't display them. So what I'm going to do is just select the ones from San Francisco County with this FIPS code of San Fran County and the state of California. So let's go ahead and execute that. And we'll look at the spatial results. Let's go back here and run the select statement. Let's just go with the San Fran County and the state of California. Look at these spatial results. In this case, we're going to, again, end up with a geospatial result that looks a lot like the streets of San Francisco. Sounds like a TV program almost. So this is going to be great because now we have these line strings. Once we create buffers around these line strings of the streets that we care about, those buffers are then going to intersect with our customer data. So we're really onto something in terms of having these geospatial data types here that we can show. So let's keep going down to the next section here. What we're going to start doing is we're going to look at this our San Fran roads geog table, which is going to be from this National Highway Planning table that we had up here. And this is basically a view that we created on top of it just to pull the fields that we care about that relate to San Francisco. Now what we can do is drill down into Van Ness Avenue, and we're going to call these two spatial temporal methods as text for this well-known text format and this buffer that we're going to basically change to 300 meters in our case. That's going to show the same line strings, but they're going to have these giant buffers around them that can ultimately encapsulate all the incident points from the customer. So let's go ahead and run this for Van Ness Avenue. You'll see that it just pulls in the road section in question. There's beginning and mileposts that we care about that ultimately are represented by these different road segments. And what this is showing us is that it's again the interplay between the binary format here and the well-known text format here. And you can see that there's more than just one lat-long pair. There's multiple lat-long pairs. And what that's showing us is that there's this well-known text format that's producing a buffer. If you go to these spatial results, you'll see that it actually produces this nice buffer size that's 300 meters wide on Van Ness Avenue for this street in San Francisco. So this is going to be great because it's going to start encapsulating all the incident points from the customer. If we run it again with a smaller buffer size, we're going to see that shrinks a bit. So that's pretty cool, I think, in terms of being able to show these different buffers. If you just want to look at the fact that you can create these road segments, we'll just do a quick look at that. We're going to use these a little bit later in some of our parameters for our report. And let's go ahead and look at, again, these road segments here. You've got the road name, the milepost, and the road segment sequence. So just kind of this is a quick creation of that view, which we're going to represent here, we're going to use in our report. What I'm going to show you now is something that Dave did in terms of being able to look at all your data here that's ultimately going to be the main query for your report. If you run this, what you'll see is that we're looking at Van Ness Avenue, we're looking at road segment sequence 1, and we're looking for specific types of incidents with a specific type of a buffer. Now, this is great, and again, we have our incident point and our road buffer that we're going to be leveraging. Ultimately, in reporting services, we'll be showing the different points around the city, the incident points, and then we'll be showing this buffer around those incident points that ultimately can encapsulate those incident points, and we can call those out and actually draw a line around those incident points. We ultimately want to be able to parameterize things like the road name, the segment, and the buffer size we want, and the types of incidents that we care about. So what you'll see next that Dave did is create these query parameters. And once the roadway is selected, then we can kind of cascade down and get the road segment. And from the road segment and the roadway, we also have something like buffer size. And we can leverage things like our incident types within the context of all these parameters. So there'll be kind of a cascading parameter, because once you have roadway, you can determine the road segments. And once you have roadway and road segments, you can determine the incident types that are relevant to those to that city with the buffer size given, as well as the roadway and road segment. So all those are going to come into play here soon, and we're going to use these different queries here to produce data for the drop down boxes for things like the roadway, for things like the road segments, and things like the incident types. And those are going to be incumbent upon things like the parameters that we send in, like road segment and roadway. So this just shows you that the incident type is going to be dependent upon things like roadway and road segment. And hopefully that makes sense. And things like The actual road segment is going to be dependent on the roadway parameter. So there's kind of a cascading nesting of parameters that we're going to be leveraging. So let's go ahead and let's go ahead and start creating a reporting services report based on this query here that we've got with the query parameters that we have. I'm going to go over into my SharePoint site, and what we're going to do is look at creating a report builder document. This is going to fire up report builder, and once we have report builder fired up, then we can start creating a geospatial report. We're going to have to do things like create a data source. We'll have to create multiple data sets that represent the main data set as well as the parameters that we care about. And then we'll add things like Bing maps and go from there. So let's do a new report, and we're going to create a blank report for starters. First and foremost, we need to create a data source. Let's call this the SF311 data source. And what we're going to do is create a connection type to SQL Server. So let's go ahead and build that out. I'm going to test that out. Great, it's working well. So we hit OK. Server name selected. It's all good. On credentials, this is an important step. I'm going to use the Windows credentials of my end user here. So now we've got a data source that goes back to our SF311. Let's go ahead and create a data set. Now this data set is going to be something that we're going to leverage from the 311 database. Go ahead and drop it in here. And again, you'll see that it's got parameters like roadway, road segment, buffer size, the incident type. All these things are going to come to play in our report. We also might want to do something just to test our report out by inserting a table here. And I'll just create a quick table on the page. Let's look at, and this really doesn't matter that much initially, but we'll just drop in things like the subject, the duration in hours, and say the neighborhood. Again, this is just, we're just using this to kind of start testing out a report, and ultimately we want to get to kind of a geospatial kind of a mapping layer. But what you can see here is our parameters are kind of dumb parameters in the sense that there's no defaults, they're not data driven at this point. So it wouldn't really be helpful at this point to view the report until we start doing some interesting design on it. What we want to do is when I dropped in this data set that you just saw, it has all these fields, but it also had parameters that we had buffer size of the road, like 200 meters, the roadway, like Van Ness, if we want, the road segment, like 1, 2, 3, 4, and the incident types like graffiti and say there's abandoned vehicles, things like that. So we need to have data for all these things to make them more intelligent. So what we'll do is we're going to go back into our data here, our query, and let's go ahead and find out what the road names are. So again, we have this road name query that we're going to put in here. Let's create a data set for road name. That's going to give us all of our road names. Now we're going to go grab our road segments. Now again, road segment is based on roadway, which we just put in there. So these are going to be kind of nested or cascading parameters that we've got coming here. Now we've got road segment. Lastly, we need incident type. So this can be the type of incident that occurs, graffiti, things like that. Come back in. And again, this is kind of the most dependent of all. It depends on roadway, depends on the buffer size that you're creating around the road itself. In the road segment, as well. So there's a lot of things that this depends on, and that's going to be kind of a it's going to be roll up as you create the, or as you select the parameters, it's going to affect the incident type here. So let's go ahead and actually, for incident type, that's one thing that we want to have as a multi-select parameter. So it's something that I need to remember when I create those parameters. But for buffer size, we know that's going to be something like an integer. We're not going to get it from a query. We're going to specify, we can either specify a value, and let's just go with a default value of, say, 200 meters. Okay, we also want to make that an integer, and we don't want multiple values or nulls, so that's good there. On roadway, what we want to do here is, for available values, get that value from a query. We're going to leverage road name, and the label and value field are going to be the same. For road segment, let's go with available values, specify a value, and I'll get it from a query. So this is going to be... Let's see, default values. The value field here is the sequence, and the label field here is the milepost. No default value, that's my bad. And then the SF311 types, we want to come into available values, specify values. Okay. That should give us a nice head start in terms of being able to get the parameters that we want. I'm also going to make this allow multiple values, and you can type in a different prompt if you want, like, something like that. So this will allow you to kind of create the interface that you want. So now we've got a 200 meter buffer. As we select roadway, like say Geary Boulevard, that automatically is going to give us the road segments that are available. That's also going to drive the incident types here. So there's kind of a cascading effect of these parameters. Now it's going back to the database, querying the incident types available for that roadway, for the buffer size, for the road segment. And now we see the different types of 311 incidents available. If I view the report here, we're just going to get back a grid of data that represents these types. And ultimately, really, what we really want is to have a geospatial representation. So let's go back in here and let's get rid of this grid, because we really want a map. And we're going to make, well, let's get rid of this execution time. We don't care about that right now. We're going to go ahead and make this a bit bigger. And what we want to do now is insert a map into this. So let's go ahead to the map wizard. And what we're going to use, you can do a gallery, you can use a shape file. We've already got a shape file in terms of our spatial data here. We want to use a spatial query, and that spatial query is this first data set that we had. So we'll just grab this data set. And what we'll have is incident points. Those incident points are actually a layer type of point. We want to use a Bing map layer, so let's go with a hybrid layer. So we'll run through this. We want a bubble map. Hit next on that. And there's also an analytical data set option. If you had a separate analytical data set, you would want to join that to your previous data set. But in our case, they're all the analytical data set and the geospatial data set are all the same. So let's just go ahead and click data set one, which is our data set. We'll use the ocean theme. And for our data fill, we want to look at the duration in hours. And we'll do it with a green, yellow, red type format showing, you know, incidents that are new versus incidents that are aged in that regard. So once this is done, we should have a lot of the tools that we need to have this geospatial report. If we run it, let's just see what happens here. Got our buffer, go with Geary Boulevard, we're going to go with our road segment, We'll pick all the incident types. And then we'll click the view report. This is then going to give us a result set that we can plot out on a map. And this is kind of nice. You can see all the incidents that that we plotted out on our map here. So you can see gear, you can see our buffer size. We want to shrink that down to say maybe 100. We can go ahead and do that. We'll view the report, and it's asking us for incident type because we have a whole new set of incident types here. Click on that, say view report. And again, it's going to go with a bit smaller segment here. So let's see how that turns out. So yeah, so it's a bit smaller. So now what we're going to do is go back and we're going to design this map. What we want to do is we want to look at just drawing a buffer around the incidents that happened on, say, Geary Boulevard. So what we want to do is click on this map, and we want to add a mapping layer. It's actually going to be a polygon layer, and that polygon layer, we're going to come in and kind of start affecting the layer data here. So what we want to do is link to a spatial field and a data set, and we're going to go back to data set one, and the spatial field name is going to be the buffer, the road buffer. So what we're doing is overlaying a buffer on top of these incident points. We'll hit OK to that. And what we'll also do is kind of go to the polygon rules of this buffer, and actually the template. And let's go ahead and make the background color no color. We'll change the border color to something interesting like this aqua. And we'll change the size of it to maybe a 3. So now when we run this, what we're going to see is it's going to draw a buffer around. Let's go with Van Ness here at this point. Let's try a different one. We'll go with the longest road segment. And we'll pick certain incident types that we find relevant. I guess it would be all in this case. View report. So what you see is it's highlighting Van Ness, and it's drawing a buffer around that. Again, if we want to try it for something like Geary Boulevard, we could do the same thing. We'll click Geary. It's going to generate a different set of segments for us, as well as it's going to generate a complete set of incident types for us as well. So let's go ahead and just select the graffiti ones this time, and maybe the sewer storm floods. Go ahead and view that. And we get the same type of experience where it's selecting the road segment in question with the buffer around that, and it's highlighting the data with with kind of a status of red, yellow, and green. Now, if we wanted to do a little bit of embellishment on here, we could kind of spice it up a little bit by adding a report title if we wanted. So we'll go ahead and click this. This is just what we were doing here is leveraging all different parameters that are in our data. So we're going to look at the 311 types that are within the parameters of the buffer size and the roadway value. What that's going to give us is a nice title that's going to allow us to get more information. And when we go ahead and run this, actually, that should have said expression, so let me double check that. I think I put it in the wrong place here. Okay, there we go. So I put that in the wrong place. I want to actually get rid of this piece here. What you see up top here is that it knows that's an expression at this point. And when we run this expression, it's going to show us that expression in terms of the data that expression returns. Let's go ahead and run this. And that we'll see now is that it creates a nice title for us, that it's data driven. And one thing that would be nice if we could hover over these points and get some information about that. And I'll also take this title and I'll shrink it down to size a little bit because it's a little obnoxious. Let's do that. Let's center it maybe. And let's go back one more time into our data. Let's grab a tooltip here. This tooltip is gonna be relevant to the point layer here. And the point layer, we're gonna come in, look at the point template, and we have this tooltip. This tooltip is going to be something that we can, again, take this type of a tooltip that's an expression or it's driven, data-driven essentially, and it's gonna allow us to get information about those points that we can just hover over and display. So let's go with Geary again. It's road segment. We'll go with graffiti incident types and again, sewer storm floods. Now when we hover over these different points, what we're gonna see is that it's gonna give us some metadata about it, and we should be looking at graffiti, mostly graffiti type incidents here, which we are. So hopefully this explains some of the process that you would go through to create interesting reports that have geospatial intelligence built into them, as well as being able to visually see things like buffers around street segments, the incident points that you have, as well as how to overlay the geospatial types that represent the different streets that allow you to highlight a segment of that street, to find the intersecting data points, and to drop that all into a Bing map that has all that knowledge baked into it and can display that information, as well as parameters and expressions that you can leverage in reporting services. You can also take this report and you can also publish it to SharePoint as an aside. So hopefully this has been helpful. And again, this is Mike Wilmot and working in conjunction with David Golub. Feel free to reach out to us if you want to have more information on this. Appreciate you listening, and hopefully this helps you create great geospatial reports with Microsoft SQL Server and reporting services. Take care.